Good afternoon. My name is Anita Cicero. I'm the Chief Operating Officer at the Center for Biosecurity. Our next panel will discuss what the U.S. can do to promote innovation and remain competitive in the life sciences. At a recent symposium on innovation, it was predicted that 90% of what will be known 50 years from now has not yet been discovered. But the increasing competitiveness of other countries and also the economic crisis of the last few years has really raised concerns about the U.S. ability to remain dominant in some areas of discovery, including the life sciences. And so for innovation to happen, we need to produce new ideas, train new talent, and foster policies that encourage innovation. So to set up this next panel, I'd ask you to consider three questions. First, are some of the drivers of innovation at odds with U.S. national security interests? In recent literature on innovation, a number of authors have expressed the strong view that to remain competitive, U.S. companies need to engage in global coordination, cross-border collaboration, rather than clinging to the traditional model of closely guarding secrets and technologies. The premise being that if nothing can leak out, it might not leak in. Adam Siegel, in his new book titled Advantage, How American Innovation Can Overcome the Asian Challenge, argues that openness is risky, but the United States must embrace it as a driver of innovation. He calls innovation the ultimate safeguard to American security. What does it mean for U.S. national security when geographic borders are becoming increasingly irrelevant in this new world of global innovation? Second, how are we doing in the global war on retaining the most talented scientists? There's been a lot of facts and figures today at this life science meeting, so I'll give you a few more. International assessments rank American 15-year-olds 21st out of 30 in OECD countries in scientific literacy. I read one prediction that in 10 years, 90% of the world's scientists will live in Asia. Foreign students comprise a significant portion of science and technology in education and also in S&T workforce in the U.S. I've also been told that upwards of 40% of the R&D workforce in one global pharmaceutical company are from India and China. So are we doing what we can to attract and retain the best talent? Third question. Do we have the right balance of regulatory and fiscal policies in place? Policies that will both promote competitiveness and also help preserve national security interests. Low-cost, high-skilled labor abroad allows U.S. companies not only to go abroad for manufacturing, but also for high-value R&D as well. Chinese policies have made a concerted effort in recent years to really shift focus away just from manufacturing to also research, design, and innovation. So do we have the right innovation ecosystem in the U.S. to keep pace with other countries? So I'd like to introduce our panel. First, we'll hear from Carrie Wolinetz, who is Associate Vice President for Federal Relations with the Association of American Universities. Carrie's an adjunct assistant professor at Georgetown and has a background in animal science. Next, we'll go to Jerry Epstein, who directs the AAAS Center for Science, Technology, and Security Policy. He's had many important positions at the Institute for Defense Analysis, OSTP, and the Congressional Office of Technology Assessment. He also served on the 2009 National Academies panel titled Beyond Fortress America, National Security Controls on Science and Technology in a Globalized World. And finally, we'll hear from Bernard Munos, who is the founder of InnoThink, which was formed to bring evidence-based innovation models to the pharmaceutical industry. And before that, Bernard was an advisor for corporate strategy at Eli Lilly, where he focused on disruptive innovation. So first, Carrie.
Start out by saying that I actually once upon a time was a zookeeper, so I feel compelled to add to Alan Rudolph's opening, not that there's anything wrong with that. But that aside, when you're looking at the question of maintaining U.S. competitiveness and what will it take, the simple, most obvious answer, which I think you just heard from Alan Leshner, is funding. Really, it's, you know, putting your money where your mouth is. And when we're talking about the life sciences in the U.S., really where the game is played is at the National Institutes of Health. And as Alan alluded to, there was this period of doubling the NIH budget in the U.S. This was an extraordinary event that occurred between 1998 and 2003. And this was the result of a bipartisan, bicameral campaign to really double our investment in the life sciences in the United States, and really allowed us to ascend in many ways to being a really global and dominant power in biomedical research in a way that no one else was at that time. What we've seen then, in what we now like to refer to as the post-doubling era, is sort of a movement away from that dramatic investment to more of a plateauing effect in funding. We've seen increases that have not kept pace with inflation. The exception to that, of course, is the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, the stimulus money, which put $10 billion additional dollars into NIH over a two-year time. And that, again, was a similar effort to the doubling campaign. It was this sort of bipartisan, extraordinary type event. But for the most part, we've seen kind of a movement away from that sort of a strong investment in biomedical research that we enjoyed in earlier times. And in fact, currently, there is a proposal that has passed the House to subtract $1.6 billion from NIH to move backwards in time to roughly the levels we saw in 2008. So you know, that sort of golden era has passed. It's interesting that this is focused on competitiveness, because competitiveness has become such a big buzzword in Washington in the past few years. Competitiveness, innovation, you saw this beginning with the Bush administration. It's carried over into the Obama administration. You've got competitiveness initiatives, the American Competes Act. And what's interesting about that is NIH is very much left out of that conversation. In a lot of ways, the life sciences is left out of a lot of that conversation. That sort of build-up with the Rising Above the Gathering Storm report, the second Rising Above the Gathering Storm report, the movement in some ways was a reaction to the doubling of our investment in life sciences, where we suddenly saw the physical sciences go, well, this is great. You know, we've had this huge investment in biomedical research. We've seen this build-up in the biotechnology and pharmaceutical sector. I mean, this has been great. It's our turn now. You know, it wasn't quite that dramatic. But for the most part, when people are talking about sort of competitiveness issues in recent years, what they're talking about are the physical sciences through, like, the National Science Foundation, Department of Energy's Office of Science, NIST, for example, and much less about the medical research and biomedical research that's done at NIH. And so what we've seen from the sort of boom and bust cycle is a situation where we now have a very competitive situation at NIH, in which you only have 1 in 10 grants funded at some institutes, and a really sort of large capacity for biomedical research without sort of the funding to sustain that for any period of time. So in addition to funding, I think the other, you know, sort of factor to think about in competitiveness, as Anita just referred to, is sort of the regulatory environment. And I know, you know, the word regulation is about as exciting and sexy as words like infrastructure. But it's really, in a lot of ways, where the rubber meets the road when you're talking about the intersection of science and security policies. It's, you know, the way we oversee, it's the way we control things. And, you know, really, we need to appreciate that, particularly in the biomedical research arena, we've seen this dramatic increase in regulation and compliance requirements. With the doubling of NIH came sort of a doubling in some ways of the accountability measures associated with that science. And so we've seen this huge growth in sort of regulatory schema and compliance costs associated with doing biomedical research. And that comes with a cost. There was a federal demonstration partnership study that was done a few years ago, which is off-cited, but basically showed that faculty members are spending about 42% of their time on administrative issues. And a lot of those administrative issues are really dealing with compliance burden, dealing with regulatory issues. And a lot of this has to do with the sort of siloed effect, which has been mentioned many times. Each of these sort of regulations, whether it's human subjects protection or animal subject protection, are individually very reasonable, perhaps, but cumulatively they add up to this huge burden. And they're often created in these either as reactionary events to something bad happening or in very disparate processes where the committees or groups or task force or whoever coming together to begin the rulemaking process don't really consider the sort of bigger picture out there. And so, you know, I often have a slide deck where I use a slide and say, look, you could conceive of a single experiment being done by a scientist where they might have to go through an alphabet soup of different regulatory hoops, the IRB, the IACUC, ALAC certification, AHARP certification, the escrow, the stem cell guidelines, radiation safety, biosafety, really a whole mix of different regulatory requirements. And this is before they even start the experiment. And that doesn't even cover all of the associated training with each of those sort of regulatory schema, which has to take place, or things like FDA requirements, which is important in the sort of dawn of translational research that we're in here. Conflict of interest, which was mentioned earlier, publication considerations, and so these sorts of pressures, these regulatory burden pressures, are really exacerbated at times of tight funding in a lot of ways, because a lot of these sort of trigger mechanisms to begin those regulatory processes takes place at the application stage or in the collection of preliminary data. And that's going on frantically during times when funding is very competitive and scientists are really desperate to get grants and continue their research. And so this is relevant, of course, to security, because a lot of when we consider these sort of biosecurity issues, our sort of automatic go-to point is, okay, we've got a threat here, we need to control it. Obviously, what we need is some sort of regulatory schema. And that's being overlaid onto a system which is already sort of at its breaking point of regulation. And I think the conversations that have been going on for a number of years now, many of you have been involved in them, of dual use research is very illustrative of this issue. You take something like dual use research, which maybe everyone can agree is poses some sort of threat. Okay, what do we do about that? How do we mitigate the threat? How do we control it? And when you start actually looking at putting this into some sort of concrete oversight system, you start to run into a lot of very difficult issues. You run into things like, well, can you define dual use research? Can you identify a dual use research experiment of concern? Having sat through many of these conversations, I would say that's very difficult to do. It's that old saw about pornography. You can't define it, but you can recognize it when you see it. And that's not a very good system on which to start a regulatory schema. So your default mechanism there is to just screen everything. Well, NIH gets something like 35,000 applications a year. You're talking about a serious inhibition of the research funding scheme here, which could really inhibit research progress. And I think it's already been pointed out a number of times that really that vibrant, robust biomedical research life sciences system is really critical to national security, to biosecurity, to biodefense. And so inhibiting it in any way doesn't seem like a very good idea. And so I think that's the balance point that we always talk about is at what point do the sort of security policies that we're imposing in real form, as opposed to the sort of abstract form that we talk about at a lot of these meetings, it's easy to say, well, we need oversight, we need control, we see these threats. But when you start looking at these things in very tangible form, it is important to try to get around those silos and consider the sort of bigger macro picture of what you're imposing on and what are the consequences, both in terms of the burden on scientists, who of course can turn their attention to other less regulated areas of science, the burden on universities, who wearing my AAU hat, I can tell you are spending billions of dollars in unreimbursed overhead costs to meet the sort of new compliance burden out there, and ultimately the cost on sort of the biomedical research enterprise and the security of our nation.
Thank you. We'll do questions at the end. Jerry?
Well, thank you. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to join this panel. Taking off of what Carrie had mentioned on doubling, I think one of the difficulties with the whole doubling process at NIH is that the scientific community thought the doubling was a verb, but the policy community thought doubling was a noun. And so it happened and it's done. And we're still living with the repercussions of that. But on the title of this panel, Maintaining Competitiveness in the Life Sciences, What Will It Take? Let me just jump to the end. I'm not sure where my 7 to 10 minute axe is going to fall, but I think the most important thing we need to do to maintain competitiveness is to avoid an autoimmune reaction in which the damage is done not by an external threat, but by an overzealous response anticipating that threat. And to look at what might be at risk here, I want to talk about what is it that the scientific community requires to prosper. I think one can take competitiveness in the title of the session, not just in the economic sense, but just talk about scientific competitiveness, whatever that means. How do we stand relative to others doing research around the world? We have seen after pursuing science for some time that excellent science requires at least two things. One is open participation. We have to permit the best minds available and interested in working on a problem to do so. We see that brains are distributed fairly evenly around the planet, one per person. And as my boss had pointed out earlier with the situation in Rwanda, there's talent everywhere and there are people everywhere. And in order to advance and do the best one can in studying, one has to open that research process so that the best people are able to participate, are able to contribute, and are able to attract others. Excellence in science also requires open communication. Other researchers need to replicate each other's work, to build on it, and to extend it. Often, researchers don't know who is in the best position to take the next step. That's why open publication, not shooting emails to 25 or 300 of your closest friends, but putting it in the literature where some unanticipated serendipitous outcome can extend and advance, and that's the way science progresses. So clearly, the tension between science and security is that if one is worried about security in the narrow sense of keeping people one is afraid of from hurting one, that is implemented by preventing information from getting out and preventing people from getting in. And so clearly there's a tension in these immediate objectives. Scientific goals are not absolute, even though one would want, on the basis of excellent science, to have as open as possible participation and communication. There are clearly other objectives and other values. So I'm not arguing that science should trump these other values. But I am saying that when one does impose restrictions for security or for some other measure, one has to recognize that that will impose a price and then decide whether the price is worth paying compared to the benefits you're getting from it. I'm going to talk a little bit about export controls and visas in particular here. One thing to recall about the U.S. export control system, which has been mentioned a bit today, is that it was designed for a world that no longer exists. It was a world in which the United States was the source of all significant militarily relevant technology. It was a world in which the defense technology base was largely segregable from everything else, could advance its own area, didn't need even the commercial base, certainly didn't need to look overseas because all the goodies were here. One could draw a circle around the United States. When something wanted to get out, you could look at it, look at who it was going to, make a decision, throw it or not. And that was within the realm of policy. You could sort of keep things inside and discuss where they went. As Alan Lester, I think, made clear, today's world is quite different. The science and technology enterprise is a truly global one. Developments can happen all over the world. It's necessary as a security matter, I would argue, not just as an economic matter, not just as a cultural matter, not just because it's the right thing to do, but as a security matter, one needs to engage globally with science and technology. One has to know what's out there that might come back to bite us. One has to know what's out there that one might want to take advantage of. A commission sponsored by the Center for Strategic and International Studies issued a report in 2005 that had said, in a world of globalized science and technology, security comes from windows, not walls. When stuff you need to know about happens outside, you have to know about it, you have to be able to engage with it. The problem, of course, is that there are foreign adversaries of the United States that do seek to get U.S. technology or whatever technology they can get, and they may be applying it to threaten or to actually commit acts that would harm this country. So one has to recognize that it would be unwise to do away with controls completely, certainly as a practical matter, but even more so as a political matter. One of the great export control system takes great pride in the fact that wherever U.S. forces have been in combat around the world, they have not come up against American-made weapons. And that's actually both actually important and politically important. Recognizing, of course, that the export control regime that governs weapons is different than the one that governs technologies have both civil and commercial applications, and that's a detail we can get into later. But one certainly doesn't want to hand things over to people who are going to use it to attack. So there is a clearly a tension between what would be most conducive to science and a political and an actual imperative to not help people too much try and attack us. Export control system primarily affects stuff, shipping high-tech products overseas. But controls on hardware, on things, can actually influence the research process, because if an item is controlled, information about that item may be controlled as well, and people who are using or modifying or redesigning or extending or maintaining those things may also have access to information which is export controlled. If a foreign national has that degree of access to this type of controlled information within the United States, that is deemed by our export control system to be an export where the information exchange happens. So one can see if one has researchers from a variety of different countries all engaging with information that might fall under control, it could be that each of those interactions would require an export license from the U.S. government, and this is not a world which is conducive for research, and it's certainly not a world which is administratively very easy to handle. Fortunately, to deal with this particular problem, fortunately for university research, the export control regulations, at least on the regime dealing with technologies that have both military and commercial use, not so much the military export control regime, the dual-use export regime includes an exclusion for fundamental research. It's predicated on the assumptions I addressed earlier that openness is essential for the scientific enterprise, science is important for both economic and national security, and as a result, the policy decision signed by President Reagan in 1985 said that fundamental research should not be controlled except through actual formal classification. And this has then been implemented, at least in one of these two export control regimes, to largely exclude the conduct, exclude the research process, information generated in the course of doing research, from export controls. The language technically applies to basic and applied research in science and engineering, where the resulting information is ordinarily published and shared broadly within the scientific community. The notion that this information is headed towards something that's going to be published, even if it hasn't been published yet, is very important, because it means that the research information and data collected along the way isn't subject to controls, even if the actual paper isn't published, if it's of a type that ordinarily would be. So the presumption of openness is important to actually keep the system open. And this is where one gets into trouble if the government imposes additional constraints on a research project, saying, this is intended to be released for the public, but we need to do a security review on it beforehand, and once we've seen it, we'll let you publish it. By that requirement of the prior security review, we've now eliminated the presumption that this is open, because you wouldn't need to review it if it were going to be open. So the imposition of that review automatically can waive this export control protection, and it has been something that universities have been trying to keep very close eyes on to make sure these clauses don't end up creeping inappropriately into research contracts. And as a result of some of these complexities and ambiguities, when as recently as 2001, research universities did not generally have full-time export control officers on their staffs, now major universities will have two or three to look at the proposed projects, particularly ones that involve foreign travel, to see whether there is equipment that may fall under some kind of control regime, and to make sure that this exclusion actually is protected in the way that that research contract is accomplished. And it's not necessarily the controls that are a problem, but it's the uncertainty that makes this difficult. In reality, very few export licenses are issued to academics. Very few, and very few of the ones that may have been requested are denied. But it's not knowing whether or not one would need to even enter into this. It's not knowing whether or not someone would have a question about a foreign national or a deemed export issue that makes this a difficult field to negotiate unless that fundamental research exemption is reiterated. Fortunately, Secretary Gates at the Department of Defense and Undersecretary Ash Carter last year did issue a memo reiterating that presidential directive from 1985, making it very clear that not only is fundamental research sponsored by DOD not to be controlled, but programs should not be managed in such a way that they will later end up in an export-controlled environment, which had been the problem earlier. Earlier, program officers had said, well, I don't necessarily see a requirement to control, but it's your responsibility to make sure you don't go there. Now it's DOD's responsibility to make sure that their program officers don't put people in that position, and that's been a great advance. And there are real consequences from this. Recently, and again, there are a lot of things that make it different, and I'll talk about that, but a retired University of Tennessee professor was recently sentenced to 4 years in jail for export control violations. This is not the dual use regime I've been largely talking about, but the other regime that controls military munitions. It was not fundamental research, it was not on-campus activity, but it was Chinese nationals working on Air Force research with clearly controlled information. But he got himself in a situation where he's now in a place he would rather not be, and universities would really rather not their professors not be there either. How this affects the life sciences is basically good news. Export controls don't, in practice, tend to be much of an issue for the life science sector. Only a few categories on the export control list address biological agents or equipment to handle them. All pathogen exports to all destinations do require export licenses, and to people who are involved in shipping samples outward above and beyond select agent regulations, this can be an issue. But overall, only about 5% of export control applications are involved in this set of arena. Most export controls involve telecommunications and computer technology. And of the ones the licenses are submitted, only so 1% or so are denied. In terms of deemed exports, only 10% of deemed exports are even in the broader category that includes biological science. And well over 99% of those applications were from industry. So either universities are appropriately recognizing that they're really not covered by this, or they're blindingly clueless. And the concern is that every once in a while, some inspector general or someone in the government assumes the latter. And it may well be that if one turned over lots of rocks, one would see things that one would prefer to have not seen the light of day. It's a continuing challenge to make sure the actual federal regulatory guidelines are indeed being implemented. Universities think that this exclusion gives them a lot of protection. It probably does, but the details have to be looked at. Let me spend just a little bit of time looking at visa policy, because again, if one wants to engage with the best people around the world, one has to let them in. So, and we also have recognized from both a scientific and competitive and economic standpoint that the United States is very heavily dependent on foreign-born scientists and engineers in science and engineering. Foreign-born doesn't necessarily mean coming here on a temporary visa. People could have been naturalized. It could be citizens. But it turns out that the proportion of the workforce with PhDs and with bachelor's degrees in the life sciences that was foreign-born almost exactly mirrors the science and engineering population as a whole. So there are some fields of science and engineering which are more dependent on foreign-born. But some 37% of PhDs in the biological bioscience workforce are foreign-born. About 15% of bachelor's degrees are foreign-born. And so one clearly recognizes that this is not a pipeline one can mess with easily. As with all foreign students, getting and applying for a visa can be an ordeal. There's lots of administrative issues. And every once in a while, the system just gets blocked up. And there have been a number of points in the past 5 or 6 years where policy changes have unstuck some backlog and permitted the more usual grinding through to take place. And so again, that's a system that just has to be measured. Most visa issues are denied not over security concerns based on technology of the applicant, but over the provision of U.S. law, which I paraphrase by saying, when a foreign student wants to come to the United States, he or she must prove to the satisfaction of a consular officer that he or she will take what he learned here in the United States back home to compete against us. The law says that's the only condition we will issue you a visa. So proving non-intent to stay, proving intent to return, is what trips up most visa applicants. And that's, again, a continuing issue. But just like people really do go to jail with export control violations, there are really concerns with the wrong people getting in the country. Again, an actual problem, but maybe more importantly, a political problem. Just in the last week, a Saudi student was arrested, a chemical engineering student at Texas Tech, was arrested for the attempted use of a weapon of mass destruction. That's an interesting oddity of the US code I can go into. But he had a chemical engineer apparently had plans to assemble explosives and conduct one of a number of attacks on President George W. Bush and or other places. This is not something any visa system wants to say had let happen. It's always at least a political difficulty. How can one argue for openness when these type of people come in? And it makes it very different to say the greater good of having a system that invites people in should tolerate people like that who are going to pose risks. In reality, risks can't be managed perfectly. One does need a visa system that uses the best available information to keep people like that out when there's information that pertains to that. But drawing a broad brush across entire fields of science and technology, deeming them to be suspicious or dangerous, is not only inappropriate, but very dangerous to our science and engineering enterprise. So let me take further issues on questions later, and thank you very much.
Good. Thank you. Bernard?
Yes, I think by now it's pretty clear that the life science sector, the biomedical research, has entered a severe innovation crisis. On one hand, we have knowledge that accumulates exponentially. On the other hand, we have a declining output of new drugs. What is less known is that what the pharmaceutical industry, for example, has done to address that issue has not worked. They've tried to produce blockbusters on demand, and that has failed. They've tried to reorganize research to resemble an assembly line so that the blockbusters could be produced on demand, and that has poisoned innovation and hasn't worked. They tried to import techniques from other industries to mitigate risk, and that hasn't worked. They tried to buy each other in a hope of reaching critical mass and all sort of arguments, and that ended up spending about $500 billion worth of investors' money with no tangible benefits. So how come we can have so many smart people do so many things which after 10, 15 years account for naught? I won't get into that. This is not a topic of the discussion today. But I'd like to propose that the one thing we need to do, the first thing we need to do when we look at innovation and how to restore the competitiveness of the life science industry in this country, the first thing we need to do is stop doing what does not work and start doing what we know works. Consider the following companies: Microsoft, Google, eBay, Skype, Facebook, Twitter, Apple, the whole open source movement, Wikipedia, Amazon.com. What do they have in common? They have two things in common. The first one is that over the last 20 years, those companies have transformed the way we communicate, the way we entertain ourselves, the way we shop, the way we work. They've changed the world. The second thing that they have in common is that they were all created by 20-year-olds who basically were out to disrupt the status quo. Imagine for a second what would have happened if the Larry Page and the Bill Gates of this world, instead of creating their own companies, had joined IBM and AT&T and, you know, tried to climb through the ranks and accede to senior level of leadership so that they could do what they wanted to do. They're probably still fighting their way through middle management, and a number of them would probably have been sidetracked as being maverick and unfit for senior leadership. So I think that's the first lesson. Someone was talking about this morning, how do you get the bureaucracy to perform, whether it is private bureaucracy in industry or government bureaucracy? The way it's traditionally been done is through, you know, process optimization. You try to tweak it and somehow oil the gears so that it works better. I think this is a wasted effort. I think the only way to get the bureaucracy to perform is to disrupt it. And this is what those kids have shown. A handful of them, 20 companies, have literally changed the world through disruption. I think the first thing we need to consider as we think about ways to restore competitiveness of the life science industry is how do we enable platforms so that, you know, the new kids, the new youngsters, can continue to disrupt us, can continue to create those sort of companies. This has not been lost on some of our competitors. In India, for example, you have the Indian equivalent of the head of their National Science Foundation, who created a platform called the Open Source Drug Discovery Platform, openly to attract hundreds, thousands of young scientists who don't know what is not possible and who are out there redesigning the whole drug R&D enterprise and are doing it on a shoestring and faster than we can imagine. Those examples need to be replicated and need to be emulated. But we also know from research that there is a number of the pathways that produce innovation, and instead of freelancing or speculating about what produces innovation, I think we need to focus on, again, what has proven to work. In government, in industry, every year, tens of billions of dollars are spent in the name of innovation. At NIH, in the pharmaceutical industry, $85 billion, private foundation, you name it. If you talk to the people who sign those checks and ask them, why do you think spending that money will create innovation? You're likely to draw blank stares. The fact is, nobody knows. I asked this question in industry when I was there. Where does innovation come from? How do you get more of it? How do we know that spending $4 billion on this program next year will produce the desired results, innovation? Nobody knew. Well, now we know, 10 years later, a heck of a lot more about what produces innovation. One of the things we know, for example, is that nearly all the breakthroughs, biomedical breakthroughs of the past, have come as a result of engaging high risk and conventional research. And what do we do today? Where do those billions of dollars go? Most of it go to fund incremental marginal research, marginal innovation. Now we only fund, or we only produce marginal innovation because we fund it. So let me propose a revolutionary idea in order to restore the competitiveness of the biomedical research. Let's stop funding incremental innovation, and let's focus our resources exclusively on funding breakthroughs. You instantly free tens of billions of dollars. Look at the pharmaceutical industry. The most popular drugs today have been supported by dozens and dozens of expensive phase three clinical trials. A drug like Seroquel, for example, has been the object of 70 phase three trials. Now, this is not research that is required to get approval. This is marketing support relabeled as research. If that breakthrough test was applied every time, you know, some of those funding decisions are made, instead of 70 trials, maybe they would have funded 3 or 4. And the rest of it could have gone to fund what is now sitting on the shelf. We talk about synthetic biology this morning. We could have added tissue engineering. We could have added stem cell, nanotechnology, and you go down the list. All that cutting-edge knowledge now sits on the shelf, waiting to be translated into something useful. The only thing that the pharmaceutical industry translates today is novel targets, and it doesn't do that very well. Now, paradoxically, the amount of money that it takes to translate that cutting-edge knowledge into prototype treatment is very modest compared to a phase three trial. If you talk to the folks who are doing synthetic biology, I mean, it's a garage industry. I mean, the costs are just trivial, puny by pharmaceutical standards. And yet, investors are not attracted to funding, you know, that early stage research for multiple reasons. I think the funding model is inadequate. And frankly, that research is crowded out by the kind of money that goes towards funding the incremental stuff. So let's restrict funding policy to, or funding policy to funding exclusively breakthroughs or potential breakthroughs, and I think we'll save ourselves a lot of money. The second thing we know is that the generation and the compounding of knowledge is a major driver of innovation. NIH has done enormous amounts to create the infrastructure that empowers open innovation with the NTRES database and a suite of, or NTRES search engine and a suite of databases and other applications. Why stop there? You can imagine a number of other seemingly inexpensive databases that could be created that could take innovation to the next stage. There has been research done at MIT a few years ago that shows that paradoxically, most of biomedical breakthroughs, most of therapeutic breakthroughs, do not come from the labs of industry, but come from physicians trying to help patients for whom the standard of care has failed. So those physicians use their knowledge of the disease, their knowledge of patients, and knowledge of pharmacology to customize treatment using drugs that have been approved by for something else. And that sort of Darwinian experimentation is repeated thousands of times across the land every day, millions of times. And some of that, by luck or by design, is going to work. Eric van Hippel, which is one of the scholars in that user-driven innovation, called that the dark matter of innovation. And paradoxically, nothing has been done to harness this discovery engine. So we could do something there. Creating a database that would allow physicians to log on interesting clinical observation about their patient, stuff that they see that shouldn't be there but are there, and log it in a way that that sort of observation could be aggregated around the internet, across the internet, and mined by volunteer. This would go a long way towards restoring patient-oriented research, which is a innovation tech approach that was pioneered by NIH after World War II, and which also has been a major driver of breakthrough innovation. Now, strangely enough, NIH no longer does a lot of patient-oriented research. They move upstream into basic biology. But I think that approach works and could be revived by using the internet smartly. The last thing we know works is collaborative research. Collaborative research is enormously powerful in lowering the cost of research and producing affordable innovation. At the moment, we have across the industry companies working in parallel, working on stuff. Some companies work on stuff that other companies have already demonstrated will not work, will fail. In that process, we not only have duplication and waste, but we also expose patients needlessly to risks. Pre-competitive collaboration would go a long way towards cutting the cost, speeding innovation by facilitating the generation and compounding of knowledge to the point where the industry, the scientists at large, both private and those of public sector, could progress much faster towards a better understanding of what causes disease so that those that knowledge could then be leveraged in a competitive fashion into the development of new drugs. But we already have 10,000 compounds that we know are biologically active. They are drugs that have been approved by FDA or by major regulatory agencies around the world, or drugs which have gone through a significant amount of development and for some reason, toxicity or whatnot, have not completed development. But we know they're bioactive and they do some good. It's amazing to me and to a number of other people that that store of molecules, which could be tremendously helpful in responding rapidly to a bioterrorist strike, such a store of molecule is nowhere to be found. You cannot go to a lab today and say, hey, you know, New York City has been hit this morning with this agent, test it again, those 10,000 molecules, so that we can know tonight if there's something that works there. There is no such system. Johns Hopkins now is trying to do something, and University of California, Davis is trying to do something, and some entrepreneurs are getting into the act, but we're not there. And when you harness, you know, the whole field of open innovation, you can cook up all kinds of schemes that will likewise heighten innovation and reduce its cost. I will conclude with one example. A couple of years ago, my former company, Eli Lilly, realized that, you know, we have screens for various diseases And in the past, we've only screened the compounds that our chemists can make. And why stop there? Why not ask the chemists of the world to send us molecules, and as long as, you know, we've got the screen, we'll just run them through the screen. It's very cheap to do. And if something, you know, turns out to be a hit, then we'll sit down with whomever sent it and see if we can negotiate a deal. It's a no-strings-attached kind of a arrangement. So they did it. They did just that. And the productivity of that effort has been incredible compared to, you know, in other words, the number of hits per for the per thousand of molecule that it has received was order of magnitudes above what Lilly, you know, traditionally would experience in its own internal research. So that that model works. Well, why stop there? Why not take it to the next stage? Why not? Why stop it? Why only screen the diseases that Lilly has an interest in? Why not invite the scientists of the world to submit assays against any disease they can create assay about? And then invite the scientists of the world to screen, I mean, to submit compounds, and you match the two and see what works and what doesn't work. It's mostly volunteer work. It costs very little in terms of organization. It can be done very quickly, but it is not done. Just an example to illustrate some of the power of open innovation. There's a lot of talk about that. There's books being written. There's scholars in this country to talk about innovation. But when it comes to translating it into a new model, it's not happening. Last week, you had an interview, an article in Chemical and Engineering News, which is the magazine of the American Chemical Society. And they interviewed big pharmaceutical companies. And in spite of all the pressure and all the evidence and all the lack of innovation, the majority of large pharmaceutical today continue to stick with a fully integrated drug R&D model, which is a failing model. They cannot think of anything else. And that takes me to my concluding remark that, in fact, cycled back to the first one, and it is, you know, you can try and spend enormous amount of effort in redirecting, you know, a system such as a big company or a big bureaucracy. You can spend your entire career and achieve very little. To really induce change, I think you've got to disrupt people into doing something else. And the best way to disrupt people into doing something else in science is to basically cut the budget, so that nobody can continue to operate business as usual. This is one thing that the pharmaceutical industry does well right now, is that they're cutting budget. You gotta do that. You gotta force people into a mode where they cannot continue to operate and have to reconceptualize their entire work in a different manner. But that recipe also works for publicly financed research. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Feel free to come to the mic if you have questions. We'll just do a few minutes of questions and try to get on track for timing. And Carrie, I wanted to ask you, you make a compelling case about the regulatory burden on scientists, but do you have any ideas for what we can do away with or reduce specifically?
Yeah, so this is actually a pretty timely topic because we've seen initiatives coming both out of the White House in the form of executive orders and memorandum and some rumblings on Capitol Hill about the idea of sort of streamlining regulation, sort of full force. These aren't specifically addressed at science, but many of them end up sort of in that scientific spectrum. In parallel with that, the National Research Council has been doing a study on research universities, and one of the areas in which they focus primarily at the urging of Senator Alexander, who sort of began that study, is the idea of sort of regulatory burden on research universities specifically. And so the sort of accumulation of that has turned a lot of attention on sort of regulatory schema. AAU, together with some other associations, Communications has recently put out a list of sort of our top 10, you know, no-cost ways to save money on compliance by streamlining duplicative regulatory requirements, for example. It's things like, you know, to stay in the biosecurity sector, if you've got a lab where you're dealing with dangerous pathogens, you know, do you need to be inspected by five different federal agencies, or is there some way you could harmonize that in a sensible way? And so there are, I think, a lot of ripe areas for consolidation and regulation, and there seems like there's a lot of interest in Washington right now to try to move in that direction.
Good. I also wondered, you know, we have the assumption, I think, on this panel and during the day that we need scientists, we need good scientists, we got to home grow them and get them from abroad and keep them engaged. But I wonder if you saw the Economist article recently that about the disposable academic, that we're actually graduating all these PhDs, but do we really have jobs for all of them?
Well, I have a personal, visceral response to this as a PhD, as a PhD scientist who happens to think I have a pretty good job. This is sort of the continuing question, and NIH is looking at this right now, actually, the sort of biomedical workforce question, not more broadly at science. And the question is always, are we overtraining? You know, and you look at sort of the fastest and largest growing pool of workers in the biomedical sciences, and it's primarily foreign postdocs, actually. You know, we focus a lot on people were training at the graduate level, but actually if you look above that at the postdoctoral level, that's actually the sort of biggest chunk of our biomedical workforce. And, you know, the system is set up now that a lot of those people are sort of in limbo for a long time. They're, you know, the average age for your first NIH grant now, an R01, is 42, which I think everyone agrees is sort of too far downstream. There's questions about whether that stifles innovation because, you know, you don't have these fresh-faced 25-year-olds jumping into the system earlier. But the sort of difficult thing to wrestle with there is that if you look at sort of, you know, people with life sciences PhDs, they're also not unemployed. You know, they have jobs. They report on sort of, you know, in a lot of surveys, kind of high job, you know, satisfaction, despite the fact that you can talk to a lot of dissatisfied postdocs in particular. And so then the question becomes really, perhaps not so much a question of numbers, are we overproducing PhDs, but are we, you know, training our life science PhDs for the full sort of spectrum of potential career options out there, whether it's in industry and sort of a very innovative, you know, approach, if it's in, you know, policymaking, which is obviously my own bias, teaching. I mean, I think that, you know, we want to keep with that idea of a more scientifically educated society, so I don't think we want to discourage people from, if you want to go into scientific research and go so far as to get a PhD and you know, maybe in some postdoctoral training, that's great. But just be aware that the, you know, the end point of that isn't always just the academic research, sort of very traditional, what we think of as a scientist PhD, that there may in fact be a lot of other career options there. And I, you know, my personal opinion is if we could get to that point, that would actually promote the sort of innovative ecosystem that we've been talking about, because it would shake up the system in a lot of ways.
Randy? I guess it's a bit of a follow-on question. Randy Larson from WMD Center. One of our witnesses at the WMD Commission, a former director of the National Science Foundation, brought us a list of recent PhDs in microbiology that had been recruited overseas to four specific countries that really provided an attractive financial package, and also, I think, less of the regulations than you were talking about that they would have to deal with filling out paperwork. And I'm wondering, is that a serious brain drain, or is that just one small data point or whatever? But it was very interesting.
It's a brain drain, but it's a reality. I mean, we are addicted to foreign scientists and engineers, but it's not clear the supply is going to keep coming, because opportunities in home countries are going to increase. We have already seen a lot of the Chinese diaspora being recruited or returning to China. A lot of foreign students are finding opportunities in their countries. And it may not be that we're keeping them out with visa policy. Maybe that they're happy to go home because they've got something to do. And the next generation, when a whole new generation of universities are built, is that they won't bother coming here at all. I mean, that's...
I'm sorry, but this specific list were U.S.-born PhD graduates. Foreigners going back.
Do they have ethnic ties to those countries, or were they just U.S.?
That wasn't said. U.S. born was all I know.
I think it's clearly a consequence of the globalization of science. We are not going to have the best jobs here. And they're going to be around the world, and people will remain at their home countries if they're not born here, and if they're here, people will look overseas. So I think that definitely could be something we'll be seeing more of.
And one last quick question for Bernard, or all of you. What do you think of the proposed NIH Center for Translational Research?
I think it's a smart idea. I mean, for several reasons. The first one is that someone's got to have the big ideas. And if you look at biomedical research today, where do the big ideas come from? They certainly aren't coming from the industry. I would say they're coming from NIH, which has done an enormous amount already to create the infrastructure that power open innovation, that enable it. But you also have some very interesting experiments that have been started at the behest of WHO. The whole public-private partnership movement, for example, they've started 10 years ago, and now the data is there, and we know that it's a model that works beautifully, develops drugs for 10 cents on the dollar, if that much. They've also recently launched the African Network for Drug and Diagnostic Innovation. Now, think about that. We're going to do drug discovery in Africa, the most destitute place in the world. On the face of it, it's a strange idea. And if you look in detail, you've got lots of disconnected facilities in Africa, a little facility here that can do chemistry, a little facility here that can do biology testing. And if you could federate all that into a continent-wide network, you could do drug discovery from soup to nuts. Well, that's what they're trying to do. The jury's still out, but given the track record that they have already with public-private partnerships, I put some money on them. Not only that, but now the Asians are looking at that, and the South Americans are looking at that, are in the process of organizing the Asian drug and discovery African Network, the Asian Network for Drug and Diagnostic Innovation, and the South American Network for Drug and Diagnostic Innovation. So then you have, some of the big ideas also are coming out of India, as I mentioned, with this open source drug discovery platform. So somebody's got to have the big ideas, it's got to exert intellectual leadership, and I think this NCTT is one example of it. But there's another justification, in my view, for moving ahead with the project, and that is industry is increasingly retrenching away from what it has traditionally done. Research in antibiotics has all but disappeared. Industry is retrenched from neuroscience, from cardiovascular drugs. Now, society, governments cannot let down those patients. Somebody's got to do the work. If industry doesn't do it, then I think it's appropriate for NIH to step into it. And now the danger in something like NCTT would be that government would try to recreate a big pharma inside government. And that is to be avoided at all costs. If the big pharma model doesn't work for the big pharmas, it's not going to work for government. It's not going to work for NIH. But I don't think NIH will do that because they've already been shown so much commitment to the open innovation model. So I think they will use the NCTT as yet another way to strengthen that commitment and to strengthen the infrastructure that enables open innovation.
Thank you. We're going to start our next panel straight away, but join me in thanking our panel. Thank you.